morning. My name is Kafui Day. Let me give you some statistics for you to chew on. So in 2012, 133 women contested 102 parliamentary seats, and 29 out of them were successful. In 2016, 137 women contested the same number of parliamentary seats, 102, and this time were successful. As at today, out of those 35 seats, 12 belong to the NDC and 23 belong to the New Patriotic Party. And I have the pleasure to introduce to you one of the holders of those seats. She is Nana Amadokuya Isiana Ejay. She is the Member of Parliament-elect for the Ikuapim North constituency, the very first woman to hold that seat. Nana Dukia, you're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Congratulations to us all as a country. We had a very peaceful elections.
Thank you very much. How were you able to unseat a three-term Member of Parliament in the person of Honourable W. Obuafo?
That's getting into our NPP internal politics.
But it's going to be inspirational for women who are watching and wondering how come a young person like you can do such a great thing. And it's a story which has been replicated all around the country, that young people are coming to Parliament. Past 2 days, we've spoken to Honourable Kojo Opon Nkrumah, a young man. Yesterday, we spoke to Honourable Ernest Nogbe from the NDC, Ashaman constituency. Okay. You're a young person. We want to know what you did. What are the secrets?
I don't know the kind of face I have. But people usually underestimate me, and they underestimate my capabilities. And I think that is what has helped so far.
You think you were underestimated?
I think I was underestimated.
Why do you think, I mean, when you analyze yourself, why do you think people underestimate you?
When I analyze myself, people would rather think that I'm less Ghanaian than I am. But I was born, bred, raised here in Ghana. I do have some experience abroad, but I'm more Ghanaian than people think, and it makes them underestimate me. I'm more assertive than people think, and it makes them underestimate me. I'm not scared of taking risks. As an entrepreneur, I've taken lots of risks in my life, and taking political risks is not such a big deal to me.
Was running for Ikuapim North the biggest risk you've taken so far in your life?
I wouldn't term that as a risk, but I would say it's so far the biggest opportunity that I've ever encountered. And for the love of my constituency, I didn't mind going and not making it in the primaries at the first time. I knew the plans that I had for my constituency were still live and potent. And even if it took 10 years or 20 years or more than that, I was going to come after them until I'm done with everything that I really wanted.
Is it because you are not a professional politician whose 100% focus is on politics, but you have other things that you do? I know you are an entrepreneur, you have a food business, and you're doing other things. You want to be a lawyer one day. Is that why you are not too worried about losing the election? Because you knew you could fall back on something?
No, that's not why. I know determination makes it. I didn't have to be desperate, but I know that I had to be determined to make it. I did have other things to probably fall back, but this was the major thing that I really wanted to do. The other things would not give me the opportunity to serve and serve my people well, but it was just through this that I could be able to unleash the plans that I have. And I knew I was going in and going in to win. I was very tactful in the kind of campaign I ran. If we are to move beyond the NPP internal politics and we are to get to the general elections, I had a very fierce competition. Irrespective of anybody saying that my constituency is an NPP safe seat. We saw other NDC safe seats falling apart like tables. We saw other MPP safe seats pouring out of the cup like water. So it took hard work and determination to be able to retain the seat. I had very fierce competition, a competition from the NDC parliamentary candidate, and then an independent parliamentary candidate too, who was the presiding member in the constituency and was able to use the developments that were going on in the municipality as his campaign tool. So that's the kind of fierce competition that I had against a parliamentary candidate who was not yet in parliament, whose party was also not in power. So it was very fierce, all kinds of propaganda used against me. Of course, for a woman to be running for such position and to be in a fierce competition, I need not tell you the kind of things that will be said about me.
I'd like to hear them. I'm curious.
Well, so much. I'm sure by the time we leave here, you'll be one of the propagated escapades that I've had and so many others. So, I mean...
Escapade, what does that mean?
Well, your guess is as good as mine.
I have no guesses.
I do. So keep yours and let me keep mine.
But I have no guesses, Nana.
You'll get one eventually. Well...
So it must be tough to run for political office in Ghana. And I'm asking you this question so that you can share a bit of your experience and inspire those who have turned on the television today and are wondering, this is interesting. Maybe I can do it. I was afraid, but she's done it, and I'd like to learn from her.
I mean, to be a woman running for parliament, especially when you're in competition with men, cowards, men who are cowards, your first tagline will be that you're a prostitute. That will be the first thing they'll try to use to destabilize you.
And that's what cowardly men do, you think?
Yes. If there are men who have the courage, who have the shoulders to be able to rap with women, they should be able to speak to you on issues. They should be able to argue with you on issues. They shouldn't do these unnecessary personal attacks. Women could be prostitutes, but who do they engage? They engage men. So as much as women who are prostitutes could be faulted, they have companion men. So there's no need bringing in who is a prostitute and who is this on the table of politics.
But were you ready for those attacks?
I would say I knew it would come, but I didn't think it would get to the extent to which it got to. But I didn't let it discourage me in any way or form.
And was this during your internal competition or during the national
one? During the national one. Mm-hmm. In the internal competition, we had three women and then one man. The one man is an honorable man, and he still is, and not him or his followers would be saying things like that. And the other women, too, there was absolutely no way we would be throwing that kind of mud against each other. It is when we got into the national one that I was facing cowards. So they would rather attack me on things they assume that every woman should be doing.
Is it the curse of attractiveness if a woman is beautiful? They will assume that, and maybe that's where the underestimating thing you said comes in, that they assume that, okay, you're going to use what you have to get what you want. How do you analyze it?
It's nationwide. Every woman, irrespective of what you look like or how you come across, that's how they tag us. That's rather unfortunate, but it tells you how backwards Ghana has gone. There are other countries that are able to project women for presidency. Liberia, even recently in USA, we had fierce competition between Hillary Clinton and then Donald Trump. But over here in Ghana...
We had an Akunedo Ajima Rawlings.
Well, yeah, we did. We did, but I'm talking about fierce competition. Yes. But over here in Ghana, a woman is running for parliament and you get men propagating about how immoral she is. Unfortunately, it looks like some men feel a woman doesn't have brains. She only has other things that she could use. But I never got onto that propaganda line with
them. How did it make you feel personally?
It was a joke to me. There was absolutely no way I was going to allow any coward put me down. So it was completely a joke and a laughable comment to me anytime I heard it. I heard it a couple of times. They would pick up their information vans with human beings sitting in, treading the length of breadth of the constituency, paying fuel, going round to be putting out such propaganda.
Insulting you.
Yes. But all in all, I stood strong, my team stood strong, they were encouraged by the determination we had, they were encouraged by us not allowing anything to distract our attention. And we went on, we sold our message, we spoke to the people on the issues that we were facing as Ghanaians, the issues we're facing as a constituency, and our plan to be able to reduce or totally take out our problems, and then they heard us.
You're married with two young children.
Yes.
What was the reaction of your husband and your children?
My children are rather young, and I have a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old.
They are aware, you know. I have a 7-year-old who was following the election, so I know that they'll hear things.
Well, did they hear things, but nothing dirty about their mom yet. But I'm not sure my kids even know who a prostitute or who an adulterous person is. So.
Didn't come and ask you, mommy, what is a prostitute?
No, not yet.
Not yet.
And my husband knew what I was getting into. So, although it probably as a human being, it will get to him a few times.
Did he get mad? I mean, did he get angry and furious? At those who were trying to do these things to you?
No, it was more sentimental to him. Why anybody would be saying that about his lovely wife? But, well, politics, it's not about sentiments, it's about issues. So it was very easy for us to get out of it.
And then you went into the election after having won the primaries. But let me just bring this up before we go to the election. Are you from the constituency? There was that information that was going around that in an attempt to disqualify you, that you were not from the constituency, you didn't come from the area.
That's very laughable. My mom hails from Amonokum, which is in the constituency, partly from Amonokum and partly from Ekopong. And my dad is from Ekopong, which are both located in the constituency. I did see that thing running on social media, but I found it very laughable. That tells you the extent to which I got unnecessary attacks.
Is it because you had spent some time abroad and people thought you were being parachuted in to come and take over a seat for which you had not taken any much care?
I was actually even a candidate for a queen mother queen mother in one of the towns. So everybody who knows me and knows me that well knew my background on that. And I haven't spent longer abroad than in Ghana. It's just things that, like I said, cowards were doing just to prevent your message from being heard from other people. So by the time you probably get to the public, they'd rather say, oh, we heard she's not one of us, she's not really here, so they'll probably not listen to us. But all in all, I'm very grateful to our constituents. They did give us a chance and did not allow the propaganda to rule.
Let's talk about the election now. So you provided some streetlights. You've done some work in the constituency. Is that what qualifies you to be the Member of Parliament for the people of Ekweapam North?
No. It is the good intentions that I have for them. It is the policies that I have for them. It's the kind of arrangements that I have with them that qualifies me to be the member. Anybody can just rise up and be fixing street lights here and there. It does not mean you have the same kind of intention to be able to move, help, assist them move their economic life. I did some assistance with streets, not just street lights, other projects here and there, cement donation here, and forgive me, I did quite a number of polytank here, this here, that here, the roofing sheets here, and even some, we even started the building right from scratch. Water projects, we did some here and there. That was all in to aid the constituency, because there was absolutely no way you would be able to explain your good intentions when the constituents in some parts did have a problem and you are capable of solving it and you don't.
Did you take advantage of some of the lapses that some of the people in the constituency thought that the former MP did not take care of to jump on that and then
like
their hearts?
Like,
well, they said that projects that were not brought to their constituency, and in a way you can understand, because for 8 years he was working under a different government, so he was in opposition.
Yes.
So it is almost guaranteed that it will be harder for such an MP to bring things into his constituency.
I never went anywhere to malign my incumbent MP. Rather, there are places where we went to and we get people singing his praises. And there are, of course, others where we went to and a couple of places and we got people who were displeased. But all in all, that's why we explained to them how important it is for them to vote for us, both in the presidential and in the parliamentary, so that all our promises and our policies will be able to be initiated and initiated effectively. My incumbent MP was a 3-term MP, and it was just for one term that he had his government in power. For the other two terms, he was more like, in quotes, a stepchild. So you were not expecting so much to come out of it. But all I did, all in all, was assisting them with what I had available, not to malign anybody. What I had readily available is all that I gave. I didn't give what I did not have. I did what I could. I shared with them everything that was in my plate. Everything was in my pocket. Everything I had is what I shared with all those who needed or wanted it.
Is running a campaign an expensive venture?
Yes, it is.
How much did you spend?
That's difficult to say, but I know it is. If you're willing your cars.
You're an entrepreneur. You run a food business. I'm sure you keep good records. You must have an idea of how much you spent.
I am an entrepreneur, but I didn't do this as business. It is when I'm doing this as business and I'm hoping to recoup my money that I'll be able to calculate my 1 cedi and 20 pesos just so that I'll be able to recoup my money.
I'm not asking as a business, just for you to know how much I spent on fuel, how much I spent on t-shirts, how much I spent on
entrepreneurs,
transport, things
entrepreneurs,
like that.
When we keep records, we keep it so that we'll be able to keep a track of our profit lines and our profit margins. But I didn't do this for profit, so I did not keep any of those records. When people wear my t-shirts or t-shirts with my picture or MPP logos in, it's so fulfilling to see them wear it. So I didn't keep track of how much I spent on t-shirts. If I could afford it, I did it. If I couldn't, I didn't.
What kind of campaign did you run? And tell us what your lowest point was during the campaign.
My lowest?
Yeah, the lowest point. I'm sure you must have had high points, but I'm interested in the times that you thought, this thing is not going to happen, or I'm having problems here. Your biggest challenges, your difficulties, things like that.
I ran NPP in all. We ran a retail campaign. And the most difficult one, I'd say, is the house-to-house. It's very easy for us to sit in our homes and assume that the candidate is supposed to be in everybody's house. But imagine working on a daily basis, house-to-house kind of campaign. You either meet the people early in the morning or late in the night, later on in the evening. During the afternoons, most people have gone to work or they're out and about taking care of their normal businesses. There are points where you get to a spot where you need to end before just to get to another program. And it keeps on dragging. The next house will be complaining, oh, you didn't come to my house. You get there, and the next house will be complaining, you didn't get to my house, and it keeps dragging. So sometimes the decision to end where you have to end is really a difficult one. Because ending there, you are offending others. And going to their end to ending there, you are offending others. But you have to end regardless as a human being. You have other programs to attend to. And I was never challenged that it will not happen. I kept my hope alive. I kept my good intentions alive. I kept my determination alive. So I knew it would happen, and I knew it would happen big.
And so now you won that election, and in 24 days, you'll be getting ready to be sworn in and to enter the House of Parliament. Just curious, have you ever observed the proceedings of Parliament before?
Yes and no. I have, but I've read a couple, is it the standing
orders?
I've read bits and pieces of it, and I'm still trying to read it a lot more to be more conversant with their proceedings and the how it is totally run.
Does your decision to become a lawyer have anything to do with your going to Parliament?
No.
Why did you want to be a lawyer? Because I know you're in law school.
I wanted to be a lawyer way before I got into the university. But, you know, with the Ghana system then, you needed a first degree before you'd be able to do the get into the LLB and then do that's how come. Well, after that, other programs, education programs got in my way here and there. But law is something that you can never retire from. So even if at a later time in life, I can definitely complete it and then we'll be able to practice and practice well. That is how come I was able to do other programs before I decided to do the law. But I'd rather do economic programs to get into Parliament than to do law. There are lots of very exquisite parliamentarians whose name cause shivers in their opponents, but they are not lawyers and they are running very well.
Do you intend to go and cause shivers in the spines of your opponents when you go into the House?
I intend to please my constituents and please them well.
Do you understand the fears of some governance experts who are worried about the influx of young, inexperienced parliamentarians and the loss of lots of multiple term MPs, like the gentleman you did defeated, and they think you may come in there with little experience, basically greenhorns?
I have a very good relationship with my incumbent MP. And, well, as much as we are enjoying the service of, we were enjoying the service of some long-term MPs, definitely they were not going to be alive forever and ever. At one point in time, they'll probably, pass away, or they'll probably even lose interest in that job. So what happens? Definitely somebody else will have to come in and then learn and take over from where they started. I go to my incumbent MP every now and then, and I'm learning from him by and by. I'm hoping to be able, even if I do not replace the vacuum that he's probably going to leave, I'm hoping to also bring a new kind of challenge over there.
What kind of things is he teaching you? So you go to him to speak with.
Yes.
What kind of things is he teaching you in Parliament?
He's teaching me how he goes on to research. He helps with a lot of research in Parliament, and how he's encouraging me to be able to do that, because that is what was helping our minority our minority leader so much. And not just the leader, the minority group that was really assisting them. And he's encouraging me to do that. But just as we hear, the beautiful ones are not yet born. We don't even know the kind of intellect and knowledge and experience that anybody can bring. There can never be the best experienced parliamentarian, because everybody brings in new kind of leadership and they all add up to give us what we get.
So it's good to know that the former MP is helping you acquire the knowledge.
Yes.
What other systems are there within your party to allow or to get you to get this information very quickly and learn the ropes quickly so that you can perform to your best in Parliament?
Even before the elections, there were workshops here and there. And if right after their invitations from here, I'm going to my regional office. There's a program there. And then there are things in place giving us the assistance, and we're actually helping one another. Just as I got the standing orders and I'm reading it, right after I could pass it on to another. MPP, we love each other, we are united. People may have different opinions on the outside, but in a nutshell, we are united and we would want to see each other succeed and succeed well. So, is organizing all these workshops and programs for us on to assist us, especially we, the new entrants. We are hoping to be able to help each other where need be.
There's a lot of young people in, going to Parliament from January 7, not just from your party, but from the NDC as well. What are your thoughts on that?
There are other experienced parliamentarians in there. It's not as if we have flushed out everybody and we are bringing in new entrants. I can only speak from my side of the party. And I know that we went through the pains of making sure that we produce the best and the best. We went through parliamentary primaries, went through general elections. Every parliamentary candidate went through vetting before they got the nod. So from my side, we know we have been tested and tried, and we are only going to produce nothing but the best.
Are you looking forward to working with the other women? There are 35 women in Parliament this time. The last time around, there were 29.
Yes.
So this is an increase of about six. And now Adjoa Bami, who is the Deputy Convener for Women's Manifesto Coalition for Ghana, is worried about the gradual increase. I mean, and she says if every 4 years, six are going to be added, it's going to take a long time to get to that magic 50% of parliamentarians being women. What do you think about the numbers and the gradual increase?
The numbers is a result of the kind of campaign that we run here in Ghana.
The one on based on insults?
Yes. I mean, you'd get people who are ready to serve but would rather sit and then hold their peace for fear of being maligned, for fear of being insulted, for fear of attacks on their family. I think the...
Why do you have the skin of an elephant? Why are you unable to be brought down by the attacks?
Well, I don't see what it should do to me.
Maybe your father gave you that confidence?
Well,
what was the background? St. Rose's? What was it? I mean, what are the reasons?
Well, if you were to check from my St. Rose's mates, I'm sure everybody will tell you right from there I had my thick skin. But I see no why insults should be able to harm me. Really, it's somebody's opinion, the same way I have my own opinion about others. And if my own opinion may not matter all the time, why should somebody else's negative opinions, which really is not true, matter? That's how I see it. And I'll encourage other women to see it and not to be looking too much about what could be said about them. Yeah. Sometimes it may get to you. Even if it doesn't get to you, you have family. My parents were sometimes worried about the kind of things that were said about me, about me being disrespectful, me being prostitute, me being this. My parents.
Your mom wasn't happy.
My mom is the quiet one and the strict Presbyterian type, and she was the least excited about the things she was hearing about her innocent daughter. And my dad was so heartbroken about the kind of things that we're saying. But I saw it all as politics. I saw it all as a real intent to break me down.
You never cried?
No. No. Why should I cry because somebody who wants to win what I want to win is saying I'm disrespectful?
So the campaign of insults is a factor that
it's
prevents
a factor,
women
and,
from taking part in politics?
Yes.
The same Adjoa Bami thinks finance is an issue, funding the campaign. How did you fund your campaign? I won't talk about the figures now. How did you fund it?
Well, I was able to convince lots of stakeholders who believed in me. So they did assist me a lot.
So is that the advice you'd give to women who want to go into politics?
When you're able to convince the stakeholders in your constituency, the stakeholders around you, that you are able and you cannot be broken down easily, and you are ready for a fierce competition, you are ready to fight to the latter, they'll believe in you and they'll be able to finance or help support your campaign. Campaign is, like, as we know, is not easy. Even fueling your car or other cars just to go around to speak to people is not an easy task. And you need to prove to people that you are up to it for them to be able to invest in you.
Were there times where you worried that the money wasn't flowing in to help you do things that you had to do?
I was never worried on that, because whenever, it's not every day that you had to be spending money. There are other times when people just wanted you to engage them, and that's fine. There are other times when you have to do projects, and that's fine. When there's something available, you use it. When there's nothing available, you use what you have.
Tell me how you felt when you knew that you had won the election.
I wasn't too excited until after I heard the national one. Mine was okay. Everybody who knew me, I had actually lost my voice right from campaign era through elections, and even till now, I still don't really have it back. But I stayed through the coalition center from 9 p.m. till about 6 a.m. when they had declared the presidential one for mine. And then about 8 or 9 a.m. when they declared my one. But although I knew we had increased our margins and increased our percentage, I wasn't. Overwhelmed with the tsunami, all I expected was a win. But I didn't even know that our God will even overwhelm us this way.
Why do you think the NDC lost so heavily?
Because they were not listening to the plight of Ghanaians. They were not giving us the solutions that we needed. They thought that the few road networks they had built and the other things they were distributing in the constituencies should be able to land them votes. But they weren't. Ghanaians were facing challenges, especially in my constituency. Healthcare is an issue. The farmers are always complaining. Horrible roads, horrible. There's no transportation for them to be able to even transport their produce to the markets. And there's nothing like a farmer watching his produce rot. These were genuine things that they were facing and they wanted solutions for. And that's why I think the NDC lost. They probably thought that giving a few people sewing machines were enough to solve everybody's problems. But Ghanaians were facing issues.
What kind of things were being shared around in your
constituency? In my constituency, hairdressers a few of them were getting hair dryers. And then...
And you could prove that they were NDC hair dryers?
Oh, yes.
What, they had stickers on them? The president's face smiling on them?
Did you see one?
I'm asking.
Oh, yes. They did have stickers on them. They did have stickers on... I wouldn't even talk so much about the spraying machine, because a few of them were supposed to help the constituents, the farmers. But a hair dryer, sewing machines, and basins. Yeah.
What we call gagba?
Yeah.
For what?
I wish I could tell, but they were distributing it across.
Were you not intimidated by some of these gifts? I mean, now you have the luxury of looking behind and see that you won. But back then, when the gifts were flowing, what was your reaction?
I was not intimidated one bit, because I didn't have to wait till 2 days to elections before I'd be able to go and give farmers spraying machines. Way before, when I started my campaign, when I advised my farmers to form some sort of cooperative groups. And that's my plan, to assist them so they can form cooperative groups and we can be able to assist them very well.
What did you give them?
Going around to talk to my farmers. Mm. There were times when I meet my cash crop farmers and I could assist them with weedicides or cutlasses or the fertilizers. These are
with your stake
to them to assist them on their jobs, and it didn't need my sticker. All it needed was the message I was adding, and that's exactly what I did.
And so the election was, the president conceded, the electoral commission chair declared the result, there was wild jubilation. And people are still jubilating, some would say excessively. What do you make of around the country of people still happy, and now we are getting reports of attacks on political party supporters?
This attacks bit, I'll pick it first, but I don't know what kind of evidence they have given. This is the NDC we are talking about. They can stay in the room and beat each other up and come out and then scream that it's.
Are you seriously saying that every single report we have is somebody staging it?
I would believe so. If we are excited,
that's ridiculous.
No, well, yeah. But if we are excited and we are rather excited about our win, why would you assume that because we are excited, we are
because
attacking?
Probably it's payback time. Because I do remember in 2008, when the NDC took over the reins of power, there were similar activities, people taking over public toilets, people attacking their opponents. And so probably human beings being natural as they are, is it not payback time?
If we have a brother to Collins Dowda saying the kind of things he said about how he kills people every day, and he's killed more than 10 people, and ready to attack our parliamentary candidate, and the police was silent on it. Is that encouraging peace? So it's very easy for supporters, example, from his side, from that parliamentary candidate's side, to be able to behave this way. But knowing the NDC, we are very good. They are very good at staging some of these things. And I would say most of these things are staged. I've heard a voice of somebody...
How about the ones which are not staged? If you say most, how about the ones that are not staged? Should people be punished?
I don't think anybody should be punished. And our party is happy at...
You're condoning violence?
I'm not exactly condoning violence.
So what are you condoning?
But peace is not just a one-way traffic. It's two-way traffic. We can advise our people that, hey, stay behind. And they also have to advise their people that stay behind. And the referee, which is the police, the IGP, and his people to have something to do. It is very easy for the IGP to be able to stop anything now, if he was able to stop something from the onset.
Are you disappointed in the performance of the police?
To an extent, yes.
Why do you say so?
It looks like it's just one part of their ears that is working. Unfortunately, but that's why God gave us two ears, to be able to listen to both sides.
Which of the ears are working?
I don't know which one is working, but well, it looks like one part is not working and only one part
is working. So the police are mono hearing, it's not stereo?
I wouldn't say all the police, but the leadership.
What, you think they explain further, I don't understand.
Well, it looks like, I'll just end it that way. It just looks like just one part is hearing, and that part that hears, only hears whispers, and they act on it, unfortunately. But they are supposed to be there for the entire Ghanaian population.
You think the police are politicized?
Part of them.
I was going to ask which part.
The leadership.
Okay. And you think things will change when the president-elect is inaugurated? Because
I'm hoping that even if they are not, the leadership is not changed, the police will sit up and know that they are not there to serve anybody's interest, but the entire Ghanaian population's interest.
Let's talk about the transition. The team was inaugurated on Sunday,
yes,
at the Accra International Conference Center. And already we're hearing interesting sounds. So yesterday there was an accusation from the MPP side of the team that they were not getting enough handing over notes, or they hadn't gotten any notes. And there was a response, predictably, from the NDC side, saying, look, we've prepared the notes even before the election took place. It appears that this, the atmosphere of suspicion and mistrust between the NDC and NPP is something that will be with us for a long time. Don't you think so?
I don't think so. All that we are asking for is transparency. All that we are asking for is details. We didn't hear this kind of complaint when we were doing a handing over in 2008.
I'm sure if we look in the records, you hear the same things.
We didn't hear this kind of complaint from the NDC. We gave them a very smooth transition. We gave them every kind of information that they were looking for. So why would they be holding back any kind of information? They should openly give it and give it out well, just as we did in 2008. That's all that we ask for. And that being done and transparency going on so well, I don't think that kind of rivalry will be going on for long.
So you think that we're in an era where there will be cooperation and
MPP, we're not asking for magic. We're not asking for magic. We are only asking for cooperation from them. And the cooperation from them we are asking for is only for them to give us all the information we require. If you had prepared these notes before election, why did they have cloths with victory 2016 with President Mahama's picture going floating around? Why did we see champagne with victory 2016 with President Mohammed?
Same as, and at the risk of sounding like an equalizer, same thing happened in 2008. We had all these pictures of victory cloth and victory celebrations that were being planned for 2008. It's natural. You choose that you prepare for a victory or a defeat. Nobody prepares to defeat.
But it's
understandable.
Yes. But this is overly done.
You've done it before, so
we may have done it before, but we did not do it to the extent.
We know
to which
you did it before, so now it's
we did not do it to the extent to which 2008 we were expecting to win power. Yes, but we did lose. Now we have cloth. Have you seen the different types of cloth I'm talking about? So far, I've seen three images.
Did you buy any?
No, I didn't buy any, but I've seen three images. Why will I buy any?
Well, as evidence.
Well, I don't even know where it's being sold anyway. I'm told now it's being sold for 2 cedis per 12 yards.
Like a reduced to clear thing?
Yeah, reduced to clear.
There's a lot of promises that were made from the NDC, and I'm seeing a lot of people demanding that these promises be kept. Do you think that you think the NPP has piled a lot of pressure on itself by making all these promises for which, if you don't solve them, if you don't fulfill them, you're going to have issues come 2020?
No. We only said what we were capable of doing.
One village, one dam.
In the north. We only said what we were capable of doing.
So your constituency is going to get $1 million this year, next year?
Yes, and we are going to work for it.
And 2018, you'll get $1 million. In 2019, you get $1 million.
Yes, and we are.
In 2020, you get $1 million.
One district, one factory, and it's going to happen. We did not say we are going to get into the government coffers to pump money to go build this one district, one factory. We are ready to give work with the private sector to make it possible. For instance, in my constituency, the constituency is automatically divided into two. We have the semi-urban section, which is we call it the Upper Hills, from Obosumase to Ekopong. With Latin inclusive, and then we have the Safro to Mangwase to Okwase area. In one village where I went to in Tenkwanta, there was this young woman who had this pottery factory producing asanka. Others call it ayowa. My cousin's
the fufu bowl.
And these other pots they call kuku. That's something we can invest in. That's something we can encourage. That's something we can give her, the support her with technical expertise to be able to make it into a bigger factory than she was already producing. We have lots of farm produce from cassava to tomatoes to maize. And getting investors to set up factories there should not be difficult. Doing this will give us productivity. All we need in Ghana is more of productivity than anything else. And when there's productivity going on, we can get our 1 million per constituency.
Will electricity bills come down? People are saying that, well, Nana is in, so the electricity bills will come down.
Hopefully.
Teachers will be paid their allowances.
Yes, yes. And we can do it. Even when we did not have access to... Even when we did not have access to the oil, funds from the oil, we were paying teachers' allowances. We were paying nurses' allowances. We had better tariffs then. So now that we are in government, we can work at it.
And then should we be surprised if after the president takes over from the 7th of January, we'll hear in a week or two that, well, we knew there was rot, but we didn't know the rot was this much, and so we may have to tamper down our promises. Should we be surprised if such words come out from your executives?
Why should we be surprised? But in any case, we said what we are going to be able to produce. So if by the end of the four-year term, we have not produced what we said we'll do, that's when you can judge us. Don't judge us from the beginning. Judge us from our end. And NDC, we didn't judge them just from the beginning. We judged them throughout their whole term, how they conducted themselves. So that's the exact same opportunity that we're asking from Ghanaians, to give us the cooperation that we need. And then give us the maximum opportunity to be able to serve them and serve them well.
And the MPP campaigned on a message of jobs, jobs, jobs. I think even on the front of your manifesto, talking about jobs. Speaking for your own constituency, I mean, how are you going to do that? How are you going to create jobs?
My number one thing to fall back is on the one district, one factory thing. This same lady is the example I'm using as the pottery factory. She had employed about 20 people. So if we are to give her the technical support and assistance that could help her enlarging her territory, I'm sure she could increase to probably 200 or 300 more people. Even before getting into parliament, I've assisted some towns to get some of our youth into apprenticeship. So that's all to increase our kind of jobs. And also, just as I mentioned, our farmers are currently doing more subsistence farming and doing just manual work. If we are there to put them together into cooperative groups and we give them the technical support, they'll be able to employ and employ more people. My other side of the constituency, where I call the Lower Hills, is purely farming and agriculture. So if we are to give them the technical support that they need, I keep mentioning it, all we see is them hiring people and then doing the manual farming with cutlasses. And if we are to get them harvesters, irrigation issues, they'll be able to employ a lot more people. And that will increase the level of employment in my constituency. For now, before even the NPP gets up to do it from the national, this is my plan for my constituency.
How has this new job, because it was actually a job interview you went for from the people of Equipim North, and they've hired you. How has this new job changed you? Or how do you think it's going to change you and your family?
Well, I would say I knew what I was getting into before I got into it. I probably didn't expect it to get that high. I didn't expect to get as busy as I probably got. Now, the campaign is over. Hopefully, we fall back to normal life. Normal life as in the new job. I'm hoping, I know it will affect my kind of family life a little bit, but I'm hoping it doesn't affect us too bad. I'm hoping to be the mother and the wife that I am, or I already am, and the daughter and sister that I already am. My family still understand the kind of job that I am and will pardon me. But I'm hoping to be able to serve my people and serve them well. To be able to use the expertise and the assistance that I'll get to be able to change their economic lives and their social lives and our education system and our health issues, just so that they'll know the difference when the woman took the power.
My wife keeps reminding me that women are multitaskers. They can juggle many balls at one time. So
exactly.
You've added MP to...
When a man is watching football, he cannot even listen to his wife or his daughter.
Well, our football is important. Talk to us after the football game is over. So you're juggling all these balls. So you've added a new ball to this. So
yes.
It's MP, you're a mother, you're a wife, you are an entrepreneur.
Yes.
Entrepreneur too.
Yes.
You're also a student. So
yes.
What will happen to school? What will happen to your business?
Everything is going to go on well. Just as it's been going on all this time, it's going to go on well. I go to school after work. And I have other, I'll say, colleagues at work in my private business. And then I see my kids when I get back home. And when I do my parents, I see them as and when I can. But it's quite often. We still do everything. We are a nutshell family, and we give assistance as and when we all need each other.
How does your elder daughter understand your new job?
My elder daughter somehow understands my new job. It's my younger daughter that I really need to drum it in. She once came to a Cropon and then she saw my posters all around and she kept on asking, "But mommy, why? Why are you wearing this blue dress everywhere?" Everywhere I go, I see you smiling in your blue dress. Why? And I heard my older daughter explaining to her, it's because mommy is trying to get into parliament. But I'm sure she still didn't understand it. It will take a little while before she gets to it.
What's the relationship with those who you defeated? Did they congratulate you, by the way?
Not yet. And I doubt they will. Right from the onset, I told you I was dealing with cowards. And cowards really... They don't concede defeat nicely. So I doubt they will. I don't think they have intentions of. But it would be nice if they do, but I do not need them to congratulate me before I know I won. The figures tell me.
And that's what you speak to?
Yes. Mm.
You're a young person, and I'd like you to give your message to the young people of Ghana, especially the women who may be thinking about a political career and listening to you may think, oh, well, this may happen. But they're not too sure. What would you say to them, the young people and especially the women?
I'll encourage everybody. I mean, if you feel the calling and you feel you have something good to offer to your constituents or your community, I'll encourage everyone. You don't even have to start from parliamentary. You can start from being in the community and then growing it from there. If it will take a while to build the confidence. But my number one thing is, do not allow anyone to discourage you whatsoever. Do not allow what anybody says about you, which is not true, to discourage you. People do say a lot of things that are not true. I'm sure those in Accra here must have heard quite a number of things about me. But just as you are a woman and then you have your conscience, so do I. And I'll say, be encouraged, be forceful. Do not allow anyone to put you down. And once you can do it and you check and you are going to be given the nod, just go ahead with it.
Okay, a couple of messages coming to us for you. This is 0288500600. This is Garinovich from Hacho. Wants me to ask you, if you were not running for MP, would you have done the projects you did in the constituency?
Way before I decided to even run for MP, I had been on some sort of assistance and done some sort of donations and presentations in the constituency. This is when I was not even a parliamentary candidate.
What was the idea in your head?
I was not vying, even when I was a student in the University of Ghana. There are records to show.
Kwamina from Tema says, you're not being realistic. How long have you been in politics?
What I don't know what he means by I'm not being realistic, but
things you don't have experience.
Realistic is
a greenhorn.
That's understandable, and Kwame, I'll take it. That's your opinion. I am a greenhorn, and I'm ready to learn. That's the most important thing.
Douglas from Dansuma wants to know if you think Dunso will ever end in this country.
Why not? There are other countries who do not experience Dunso, and it's because of the kind of leadership and the kind of dedication that they attach to it. So with the right leadership, Dunso will end. And I think that is now.
Would you be excited if you were made a deputy minister?
I'll be excited in every capacity that my party would nominate me to serve. If my party sees me as in my capacity as a member of parliament to be able to help and help my constituents, that's fair. If they think that I have the expertise to be able to hold a deputy minister too, that's fair. But I have actually dedicated myself to serve, not to lord on anybody. So in any capacity that I'm given to serve, I will, and I'm hoping to be one of the best leaders that Ghana will ever have.
What's your final word for our listeners, our viewers?
To encourage everybody to cooperate with us. We voted about a week ago today. We've won power. We are about to get into government. Transition is going on. And we encourage everybody to continue to cooperate and then believe in NPP. Believe in our policies. Believe in our intent. And believe in the love that we have for our country and everyone. And all that we are going to do is to use the resources to work, not to use it for any other ulterior motive. Believe in us and continue giving us the support that you have given us from the onset. And it's our promise never to let anybody down. Thank you.
I just realized that your initials are the same as your president-elect, NADA. Nana Amadukia Isioma Ejay, MP-elect for Ekwepi North. Thank you very much.
Thank you, too. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Pleasure is mine. All right. And that's your Hard Talk. Thank you.